Öğleden sonranın son iki konuşmasına geldik. Şimdi Doktor Cengiz Öztireli bizimle. Cengiz Öztireli Koç Üniversitesi'nde sınıf birincisi olarak bilgisayar mühendisliği ve elektronik mühendislerinden çift anadal derecesiyle mezun oldu. Daha sonra yüksek lisans ve doktora derecelerini ETH Zürih'ten aldı. Şu anda kendisi hem University of Cambridge'de hem Google'da bir pozisyonu var, hem de University of Cambridge'de Associate Professor görevinde. Araştırma alanları computer graphic, bilgisayarlı görme, yapay öğrenme, yapay zeka ve özellikle bunlarla üç boyutlu dijital gerçekliğe odaklanmış durumda. Çok başarılı bir araştırmacımız, katıldığı için çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Kendisine Eurographics Best PhD Thesis ödülü var, Fulbright Science ve Teknoloji ödülü var. Aynı zamanda UKRI Geleceğin Liderleri Fellowship'i var. Sizi aramızda görmekten çok mutluyuz Cengiz Hocam. Söz sizde.
Ben de katılmaktan çok memnun oldum. Evet,
Şimdi.
bugün biraz işte bizim alanlardan bahsedeceğim. İşte tabii işte bizim terimler genelde İngilizce olduğu için bütün sunumu İngilizce yapmaya karar verdim. Biraz önce onu konuşuyorduk. Ama sunumda göreceğiniz gibi aslında alanlarımız yavaş yavaş birbirine kaynaşmaya başladı. Terimler de büyük ihtimalle ben tabii Türkiye'de uzun zamandır olmadığım için büyük ihtimalle gelişmeye başlamıştı Türkçe terimlerde. Ben çok hakim olmadığım için bugün İngilizce olacak. İşte bizim alanlar computer graphics, vision, machine learning, şimdi artificial intelligence de diyorlar. Son böyle bir 10 senedir. İşte deep learning, işte neural network kullanarak optimizasyonlar yapmak, bunlarla bazı inverse problemleri çözmek vesaire. Bunları hep aşağı yukarı hepsi merge olmaya başladı. O yüzden aslında bu interpretability çok önemli bir hale geldi. Son 5-10 senede diyebilirim. Çünkü bizim algoritmalar çok değişti. Daha önce işte doktor öğrencilerimiz daha basit bir demeyeyim de daha anlaşılır algoritmalarla çalışıyorlardı. İşte bunun teorisini önce koyuyorduk. Sonra teorinin üzerine inşa ediyorduk algoritmayı. Bundan yaklaşık bir işte 2012 diyebilirim, bir 8-9 sene önce bu işler başladı, deep learning işleri. Ve biraz alan aslında biraz bayağı değişti. Yani benim son işte birkaç senede mezun ettiğim öğrenciler genelde tezlerinde işte bir neural network'te başlıyorlar. Bu neural network tam olarak ne yaptığı anlaşılmayan bir neural network aslında oluyor genelde. Daha sonra bunu yavaş yavaş işte geliştiriyorlar. İşte farklı algoritmaların zayıf noktalarını bulup onun üzerine gitmeye çalışıyorlar. Ama bazen ve hatta çoğu zaman diyebilirim, teorik olarak bir şeyin neden tam olarak çalıştığını anlamıyoruz. Bu tabii bilimsel olarak çok iyi bir şey değil. Son zamanlarda, son 5 senede diyebilirim, biraz daha bu alanlar gelişmeye başladı. Mesela bazı teoriler var şu anda. Hangi tip architecture'ların hangi problem için daha iyi çalışacağına dair. Onun üzerine de çalışıyoruz şu anda. Yani bu aslında gidişattan pek çok insan son zamanlarda pek memnun değildi ama işte bu son 5 sene diyebilirim daha bir toparlanmaya başladı bu işler. O yüzden de ben de bu alandan biraz bahsetmek istedim. Interpretable deep learning'den. Interpretability işte bahsedeceğim slide'larda. Aslında şey demek, bir algoritmanın insanlar tarafından anlaşılabilmesi, işte onun üzerine çalışılabilmesi genel olarak. Ama bahsedeceğim gibi işte tabii bunun farklı çeşitleri var. Farklı algoritmalar için farklı interpretability tanımları var. Onlardan biraz bahsedeceğim. Ama işte şöyle başlayalım. Şimdi yavaş yavaş İngilizce geçeyim isterseniz ki çok karışıklık olmasın İngilizce Türkçe.
Sizin slaytlarınızı da açalım mı isterseniz?
Anlayamadım.
Slaytlarınız şu an açık değil.
Share screen o zaman hemen tekrar bir share screen yapayım. Pardon. Ben tekrar başlatayım. İkinci. Şu anda geliyor olması lazım.
Şu anda geliyor, evet. Arada ben devraldığım için kusura bakmayın.
Doğru, pardon. Haklısınız, doğru, onu unutmuştum. Şu an görünüyor mu?
Evet, evet. Buyurun.
Okay, so yeah, so today we'll be talking about interpretable deep learning. So as I was saying, deep learning has become kind of the norm, actually both in industry and academia, for solving a lot of difficult English problems over the last 10 years or so. And both at actually Cambridge with my students and at Google with my researchers, we basically day-to-day using different architectures to solve such difficult problems. And one big problem we have, I mean, both from a scientific perspective and from actually a legal perspective, I'll just talk about it, is some of these algorithms are not really interpretable. And this is not good, of course. I mean, we want to understand what we do for different reasons I'll discuss. But first, let's try to actually, you know, some successes of deep learning. I mean, there's so many of them. So one, I think, stunning success has been this phase synthesis algorithms. We also work on this. So sometimes this is called generative approaches. Sometimes people actually confuse it with GANs. So GAN is actually one type of generative algorithms. But basically the idea is you can actually generate faces of humans that don't exist. And the faces actually look pretty good. So in this example, you have basically features from three different faces that you can combine to generate a new face. And it actually looks really realistic. And I've been working on this problem from a graphics perspective for a lot of years. Actually, I worked at Disney for 3 years, and there it was the same problem. So basically, generating faces or synthesizing faces from a graphics perspective is really hard because you need the geometry, you need the appearance, and you need to put the light. So basically, you need to put the whole scene in place before you can realistically render a face. But in this case, it's kind of a really shortcut. So you can combine different features and generate a new face that looks realistic, and all the material properties such as subsurface scattering, etc., is there. So, I mean, this was actually a great success. And I think this was actually one driving force behind, you know, all the, I don't want to say hype, but basically all the tide behind, you know, deep learning approaches. And yeah, I started to realize deep learning pretty much in 2013-ish, and then in 2014, I started working with these architectures. And one basically primary example was always faces. But we have also some other a bit more real life, let's say, examples. So in this case, we tried to run the algorithms on X-ray scans. And the idea was actually, can we detect abnormal bones? So if there's any deformation in a bone, can we detect that deformation, basically do something about it? And the claim for some of these algorithms is actually that the algorithms can perform as people, so as well as doctors. And of course, this is not always the case. This is the case for certain types of certain subsets of data, but it was still actually a huge success. I mean, before this, of course, I mean, this is not always true, but people would say, you know, computer graphics works, computer vision never works. You know, there was a saying in my field, of course, it's like a biased idea about computer vision, but so these kind of approaches started to appear, and basically we started to realize, okay, now we can really solve such English problems, and you don't even need to do so-called feature engineering, which I will actually talk about next. So I think this is a good way to introduce interpretability. So this has been the norm over the years, right? So we first would actually extract features before we go on and solve a problem. So in this case, the problem is classifying X from pants. And you might say, well, I can already see there's a structure here, right? So I can, for example, fit circles, or in this case, ellipses actually. So then I can say, okay, I had a longer axis and a shorter axis. And if the ratio of these two actually close to one, then maybe I can say this is more like an egg. And if it's a bit larger, then I can say this is more like a pen. And then basically you have kind of this one-dimensional classification problem, right? So you can just set a boundary and then you're done. So this kind of algorithm is based on feature engineering, which has been the norm actually for computer vision and machine perception for a lot of use, is really by construction interpretable, right? Because you can say, well, I mean, this is really well defined. So I have the ellipses, I have my one dimensional space. If a new image comes, I can always say, okay, I fit a new ellipse and just see if it's really doing a good job. Or actually, I can already see how it fails, where it fails. So basically, everything is really clear in this algorithm. And then you can compare this to what we do today, which is basically just feeding all these images into neural networks of really large sizes. And then it generates probabilities of different classes, basically. So in the first image, you say, well, the probability of this being an egg is higher than the 10, etc. And then you actually don't know what's going on, right? So you have this huge network, for example, FastNet or a UNet, etc. And then you say, okay, I mean, I have 5 million parameters, and some of these actually were active, some of these actually helped me to generate this nice result. So let's say I have 95% accuracy. But then it's not really clear which nodes or which part of the network or what kind of features actually in the network really contributed to this output. So this is the main problem, right? So we really need to understand what we're doing in order to first, I'll talk about this a bit more, in order to first basically extract certain properties and understand what we do. And also from a legal perspective and actually also from a performance perspective, although I know this part of the summer school is not about performance, but actually it also affects the performance quite a bit. So just to make it a bit more concrete, Let's say we have a classification problem and we have basically X-ray scan as before, and we say, okay, this is actually normal, right? So somehow the classifier decided that this is normal. So the classifier is some neural network that we constructed somehow. And then another scan comes and the classifier says, well, this is not normal. So then the main problem and the main reason why we care about interpretability is basically, did it really look at the correct structures? Did it really do what it was supposed to do or what we expected to do? For example, did it really look at the bones in this case? Or did it somehow correlate these two lines to this abnormality? Because our data sets are always biased, right? So you could always have some artificial correlations in the images you have in this case. So then it's always a bit of a problem. In practice, it's also a big problem. For example, at Disney, we used to have cases where we want to do something with humans, but then, you know, there were some structures behind, and basically it was really skewing our results because just the network tries to overfit to those pixels as well. So this is in practice also a big problem for performance, but if you don't understand, we cannot really do much about it. So this is the main topic of today. So just to break it down into three actually fundamental pieces why interpretability is important. The first one is transparency. So as I've been just describing a bit, we really want our algorithms to be transparent, both because of basically scientific considerations, but also from a legal perspective. For example, in the EU, there's this law called right to explanation, and you cannot really have an algorithm that decides on your life. And then you can just say to the person, well, I mean, you could not get the insurance because just the algorithm said so. This doesn't work. So you need to really have an explanation. This is called right to explanation. And if you just throw in a neural network at this problem, basically it's really giving you some output without any explanation. So this is a big problem. The other one is, as I've been saying, we need to understand what we do, otherwise it's not science, it's something else. This is also very important. And efficiency or performance in general is actually heavily affected by how we interpret the networks and how the networks actually interpret the data. So this has been actually quite a bit of discussion and work in my field. There are a couple of very interesting papers it, it appeared and basically based on those, and of course hundreds and hundreds of papers that appeared afterwards. So as a matter of fact, for most of the networks, actually the network is like not most of the part of the network is doing anything. So basically some neurons are just there, but they don't know much. Some are there, but they completed that. So it's really interesting because you can really reduce any or most, let's say, most conventional general architectures to, for example, 20% of what they are. I mean, instead of 5 million parameters, you could, for example, have 1 million parameters. And then you can get pretty much the same performance. And I've been working on this as well. And this is really interesting because it basically shows me that what we do is an overkill, right? So, and this is also very dangerous, right? Because you're overfitting them to your data. This is like a well-known result in machine learning. So if you have a lot of degrees of freedom or a lot of capacity in your algorithms, then your data permits, basically, then you're really overfitting to the training data. So this is always a big problem. So yeah, I hope I could explain a bit why interpretability is really important for us, especially in the scope of deep learning. And now I want to talk about basically what is interpretability, what types of interpretability are out there. And then we will also go into a bit of technical details actually on one of these. So fundamentally, algorithmically, this is not actually about deep learning, you have two different types of interpretability. So the first one is interpretable by construction, meaning that, for example, you have a decision tree, or you have this example I showed you, like a 1D classification problem. So basically, by construction, it's really easy to interpret what you're doing. And the second one is basically you have an algorithm, such as a neural network, and you try to make it interpretable in some ways. And this is actually the topic of today, basically. And if you think about this, it's actually a pretty hard problem. We have millions, sometimes billions of parameters in a neural network. And there's kind of a zoo of neural networks. Of course, like over time, some of those die, some of those remain, some of those are merged, etc. But you don't know at a moment in time, you actually don't know which ones are good, which ones are not. I mean, there's so many different conflicting results here and there, left and right. And this is basically because of the data sets and the actual task and the problem. So how do you interpret all these different architectures with a lot of parameters? This is actually the main challenge we have. And for deep learning, I should say there are two main approaches. So the first one is a model-based approach, meaning that you actually really try to interpret the whole neural network for any types of data, any kinds of data. So you're saying, you know, I have this neural network I trained, and then I say, okay, what parts of the network actually contribute to the results I'm getting, like the accuracy I'm getting, for example, over all classes, over all data. And the other one is more like a local approach to interpretability. It's like really for a given input output, you try to understand which parts of my network contributed or which parts of my input actually contribute to the output. So, I think a good example for the first one, the model-based one, is basically this visualization of filters in computer vision applications. So in this case, you want to classify an image. So we say, okay, this is a car. And if you look at these filters that this convolutional neural network is actually learning, you can visualize some of those exactly, some of those approximately. And you will really see what's going on a bit, right? So you say, okay, for the low-level features, looks like an edge detector. For the mid-level features, well, looks like a smooth, you know, part detector. And for high-level features, now you actually start getting into a bit more high-level or higher frequency details. So you can already, for example, see here there are some eels appearing roughly, right, in this visualization. So I think this is an interesting way to interpret what you're doing, but it's not like a quantitative way. It's not a way where you can really say, okay, why this network decide that this is a car? I mean, this is, yes, we have some picture that resembles some parts of the car, but you really don't know, like, at a fundamental level, how to interpret the output and how to make sure this plays gracefully, etc. So this is like a way to kind of see what's going on inside the network. And I think an interesting and important example for the second part, the input-output part. So basically, given an input, a network, and an output, trying to understand which parts of my network or which parts of my input actually contribute to the output. So this is basically the idea. And the thing that you get typically in this case is almost like a heat map or like an importance map, right? So if, for example, in this case, you're saying, I want to classify a dog and a cat. And then you actually realize you're getting correct results. And now you want to understand which pixels contributed to this results most. Right. So, and then you can say, well, for the dog, the blue pixels actually contribute the most. And for the cat, the red pixels. In this case, actually, it's a good case because you're saying the network is really looking at the correct pixels, right? It's not looking at the background. It's actually looking at the foreground characters. So this is a good case, but it could also be that, you know, the network is not doing a good job. So basically, this is really input-output dependent quantification of interpretability. So yeah, the first one is more global, the second one is more local, basically. So I actually would like to start talking a bit about the global understanding. And the first thing is visualizing the world database, as I've been mentioning. So this is interesting. Right, so especially for convolutional neural networks that we use on images and geometry as well, this actually gives kind of an insight into what we're doing. But it's not a, like a, it's not, let's say, the most informative way, and it's not really a quantitative way to understand what we're doing, especially for example, classification problems. For regression problems, it's a bit of, I think, a better case because you can roughly see if the filters are capturing certain structures, if they are translation invariant. So then at the output, if, for example, you would like to transform this image, like this car, to actually a different color, then you can see, well, is it really capturing the shape of the car? Is it really capturing the color? So it gives actually an idea. But for classification problems, which are actually kind of the most important cases for interpretability, this is not the best way to interpret your models. And the other very interesting way is actually basically optimizing for images or for input in general, such that you actually maximize the probability of a given class. So for example, let's say, yes, our classifier output like a husky. And then you say, well, now I want to generate an image that would give me the largest probability for the class husky. So then actually you get pretty interesting patterns. This is something we did actually for geometry as well. I'll talk about it later. And for the husky case or for the other case, you can roughly see that there's like silhouettes and some of the structures of these objects. And they're kind of all around, right? This is kind of a really, really interesting result that also led to a very interesting paper. Probably know this one. I actually don't have any visuals from that, but this tile transfer paper, basically you can actually transfer. So you can take a photo and just impose a style on it. For example, it like looks like a Picasso painting, etc. And this is basically because of such patterns you see in the networks, and you also see it here. So kind of this translation invariant capture of textures here and there, and sometimes they start forming larger structures, and it's quite interesting, I should say, but it's also not, if you think about it, not the best way to interpret what you. So of course this is just my personal like opinion on this, like my personal take on this, but basically I think this one is pretty interesting. Surrogate models. So this means you actually train another model that tries to generate the same results as your original one. So in this case, we have a neural network that's classifying numbers. So we have a hand-drawn or hand-written tool. And then now we actually output the probabilities of different classes. And then we say, okay, instead of this neural network, can I actually have a kind of a decision tree, for example? Of course, the decision tree is much more interpretable than what we get from this neural network. And what you do is essentially train this new algorithm, this, in this case, the decision tree, with the same input and output that you actually can generate from the original network. And then once you train this, if you get similar results, then you're saying, well, I can replace pretty much my neural network with this new one. Or I can say, well, yeah, this is kind of an approximation of my neural network, but it already gives you some insight into, you know, what could be examples which would fail, etc. So I think this is actually a quite interesting way to interpret your models. The other one, the last one actually I want to talk about for the global case is also quite interesting. And that's basically trying to understand which data points in your training data actually influence the output for a given test data. So in this case, we say, okay, we have a car image, and we want to classify this car image as a car. And then you're saying, okay, this classification was correct. So like the car probability is high, but which ones, like which training data actually influence this decision? So this is also a very interesting and a nice way of interpreting your algorithms, because imagine that there was a person and she wanted to get a, like some kind of insurance, and the algorithm says no. Then you can always go back to the algorithm and ask, but why did you say no? So which actually patient data did you correlate this patient data with? And then you can already get a list of different patients, and basically you can see what's going on a bit. So this is also very interesting and in some cases very useful. But of course, this is not the end of the story, right? I mean, still, it's not like a quantitative way of interpreting what you're doing. Still, it's a bit vague because it really depends on your training data. But this is very interesting, and actually, there has been some progress on this front as well, especially when you integrate algorithms into practical systems. So this has been so far the global picture, right? So you have an algorithm, in this case, like a neural network, and we say, okay, independent of what input-output I have, can I have some generic approach, basically some approach where I can interpret what the network's doing? The other one, as I was mentioning, is actually more like a local understanding. So you say, okay, for a given network and also a given input-output, how can I understand what's going on in the network? So this is really then really depending on what input you have, what output you have, right? So this is basically the main difference. And for this case, for this type of interpretability, actually the technique I would like to talk a bit more in detail is called attribution techniques. So an attribution technique is basically attributing any kind of importance, so basically assigning an importance to different parts of a network or different parts of an input. So this is the main idea. And just to make it a bit more concrete, so let's say we have actually a classification problem again, and now we would like to classify a snake, and we have a classifier, and basically that actually gives us a nice result. So this is a yes, and the probability that this is a Gartner snake in this case is actually high. So now you want to understand if this algorithm, this classifier, the neural network really looked at the pixels it was supposed to look at, or at some other pixels that we don't care about. So what an attribution technique basically takes is that it takes all of these and gives you, in this case, almost like a heat map, like a per pixel importance map, right? So you have for each pixel a score. And in this case, actually, we see, okay, the red ones, actually, they're high scores and blue ones are low scores. And we see it's actually really cared about this thing, not the background. So this is actually a good case. And in general, you can do the same for and then nodes in the network, all different types of input you have. So in general, you can assign basically to each and every node and each and every input the dimension you have and importance. And then you can say, well, yeah, I mean, this pixel wasn't really important, that node wasn't really important. So then you can really understand what's going on for this particular input classifier and output set, basically. So then the question, of course, becomes how do we do this? How do we measure the importance of each pixel for this input-output pair? And actually, this is a screenshot from a couple of different techniques that we've been exploring. And as you can see, different techniques really give you different results, right? I mean, sometimes some techniques says, well, the network cared about the mid pixels, like for example, as in this case. And sometimes it says, well, it really cared about all the lines. So there's always different interpretations of what the network actually did for us. And this is a big problem, right? So if you think about it, so what would be the best? I mean, we don't know what the network is doing, and we don't know which of these techniques actually give us the kind of more correct interpretation of what the network is doing. So this is really an impulse problem. It's very difficult in general. I'll just talk about how we actually tackle this in a couple of slides. But in general, if you think about it, it's actually pretty impulse problem because we, as humans, we have an idea, right? So we know, okay, for a number, we need to look at maybe the silhouette as humans, but as a neural network, it might not be that particular feature humans care about is really important. So in this case, sometimes people tend to think, oh, okay, this particular interpretation or this attribution of algorithm works well just because it kind of correlates with human perception, but actually that's in general not the best idea. I'll just talk about it in a couple of slides. So attribution is not only important for classification problems. Actually, in this case, we've been also using it for a lot of different regression problems. For example, pose estimation. So this is a screenshot actually from our recent work. In this case, what we want to understand is the network is really doing a good job at estimating the pose, meaning that it's not only like the output, but also is it we're looking at the correct pixels. Because this is really important if you want to attack such systems, right? If you want to attack a system such that you will actually destroy basically output, right? You say, okay, I have a certain, for example, short, actually, that's the example I'll show in a couple of slides, that actually will completely make the detection infeasible. If the algorithm is not robust, you can actually do that. So in this case, the attribution looks a bit like this. So for example, if you want to detect the elbow joint, the attribution technique can give you such a map as you see over here. And basically this tells you, okay, the pixels around the elbow actually were important for detecting the elbow, right? So, and this is what we expect from a network that's actually doing a good job. And again, if you don't have any theoretical guarantees about the attribution technique we use, it's not really clear, is the attribution technique is doing a bad job or is the network is doing a bad job? So it's really important that we have a theoretically well-founded attribution technique. And this is basically the first desired property I will have. So we need to have some way of saying, okay, this is in a certain sense, in a mathematical or game theoretic, in some sense, this is actually a technique that makes sense, right? Because otherwise you don't know if the network is doing a good or bad job, or as the attribution technique is doing a good or bad job. And the second very important property for any attribution technique is actually should be implementation invariant, meaning that it's basically, it has like some mathematical form, and this form should not depend on how you actually implemented it. And this is of course very important, because otherwise you could just tweak your implementation, and you can basically get the result you want, right? So you can say, well, you didn't get the insurance just because, you had this chronic illness, but maybe the reason was something else. So it's really important that actually it's implementation invariant, and it's like a universal technique, independent of which language or which framework you implemented it in. And of course, the third very important property, I'll talk about this a bit more, is it should be efficient. I mean, we're talking about millions of parameters. We're talking about real-time systems. For example, if you have a system that actually gives you some instructions on driving, or so many people and companies are working on this. Basically, the car drives itself, right? autonomous driving. So in this case, it's actually, it is really important that the system is real time and you need all these fast algorithms. So there are a lot of different algorithms for attribution techniques. There's like hundreds and hundreds. And this kind of all this zoo of algorithms. And actually, I started working on this problem, the attribution techniques, I think 5 years ago or so. And at the time we started, it was already hundreds and hundreds, and now it's like grown quite a bit, like exponential growth in these fields. And the good thing, like the good news, let's say, is actually you can unify most of these in the same framework. I mean, I should not say most of these, but a lot of these. So actually we worked on this, we published this work in a couple of papers. Basically, you unify all these techniques that work with certain tools, let's say, in the same framework, which was actually a great way to understand them as well. And then this is the technique. Actually, I'll go a little bit into details about this, the Shapley value based one. So this is a technique that's a theoretically well-founded one. It's actually based on some game theoretic optimal concepts. So as I said, this is actually really important. So after you understand, okay, these techniques are doing this because of this and that, so then you start thinking, I mean, yes, this is good, but what would be the ultimate technique? So what would be a technique that actually would make sense from a certain theoretical perspective? So in our case, Shapley value is actually a game theoretic concept, and it's an optimal way of quantifying basically contributions of people in a coalition in a game theoretic sense, right? So this is actually really important. As I said, if you don't have this theory behind, it's not clear if your attribution technique is doing a better job or if the network is doing a better job. So I want to briefly describe this because I think this is a really interesting, simple concept that actually we could apply after some thinking to a deep neural network. So Shapley value, as I said, is actually a game theoretic concept. It's really trying to quantify the contribution of a person in a coalition to some output. So let's say we are three people, right? And then we want to develop something of value. In this case, it's a game console. And then you say, yes, and this is nice, we can sell this for $100. But how much did I actually contribute to this $100? So this is basically the fundamental question Shapley values has. And the answer is surprisingly simple. Basically, what you do is you add and remove yourself to each and every subset of these people. So you say, okay, I have this subset of two people, and then I add myself to this subset of two people, and I can quantify how much I can sell this console with three people and two people. I can just subtract these two, and then actually do this for each and every subset. Basically, I am adding myself and removing myself from each and every subset and just subtracting these outcomes. For example, maybe if we were three people, we could sell it for $100. If we were two people, we could sell it for 50. So basically you take all these differences for each and every subset and you just sum them up. And this basically gives you how much you contribute to this product. So of course, in real life, this is not always feasible, right? Because you cannot really say, well, I now have a team of two people, so let's try to construct the same thing again and try to sell it, and then do it for like a single person. This doesn't work, right? But theoretically, this is actually the optimum thing to do. And this is actually great for us because we can do it, right? So in networks in deep learning, we can actually add and remove nodes, add and remove parameters or input pixels, and really measure the difference before we remove and after we remove. So we can do it. So we can do all these experiments, all the real life doing such as experiments is not really easy. So this is all good. And as I said, this is actually really, in a game theoretic sense, the optimum thing to do. But the main problem is this actually has a combinatorial complexity, right? So basically this is a combinatorial problem because you actually have to work with each and every subset. So then our idea was basically we don't really need to have each of these subsets. We can actually statistically estimate what we would get if we would have kind of a distribution of these subsets. So let's say we have a classification network in this case. So we have this label one, and then this outputs a probability, a high probability for the class one. So it's a good one, it's a good network. So we want to understand actually which pixels contributed to this output. And you would like to use Chappie value. So normally what you would do is basically remove the first pixel and then compute the Chappie value. And basically that becomes the attribution for the first pixel. And remove the second. So basically you actually remove each of these pixels from each and every of the subset of all these pixels. So if you have a million pixels, then you have, you know, 2 to the power of million subsets. So this is not feasible, obviously. But what you could do is actually you can say, well, I actually can quantify if I can have a distribution of my subsets. Actually, this is because of you know, classical laws in statistics and probability. This is actually a Gaussian. And if I have this Gaussian distribution to start with for my subsets, I'll unfortunately not be able to go into details, but I just try to give you the main idea, basically. So if I start with this distribution, can I construct a new network that derives from my original networks such that actually I can I can basically warp this distribution all the way through, and at the output I'll have a different distribution which I can use to compute my Chappie value. So this is roughly the idea. I mean, unfortunately I'm not able to go into details, but basically the main takeaway I think from this slide and from this technique is basically you can statistically estimate the distribution of subsets instead of really going in to each and every subset. So this is the main idea. And actually once you can do this, you can apply it to a lot of different problems, like from DNA sequencing to image classification. And we tried it on a lot of different problems, and for all these cases actually we could get really accurate results, meaning that we get deep Chappie values very close to the actual theoretically optimum Chappie values. So yeah, this is actually a bit more deep dive into this one. I hope it was not, it was a bit hand wavy. I'm sorry about that, but I just tried to give you an idea like about the activities in this area. Attribution is very active area. In general, this local interpretable is basically given an input, output, and a network, trying to interpret what's going on. This is a very active area. And this is actually for good reasons. I'll just finish up by basically giving some applications, just talking about some applications. And then hopefully it will be a little bit more clear why actually we care about this in practice and industry as well. So of course, the first one is, as I've been mentioning, by law. For most of the time we are bound, so we need to have an interpretation. For example, if it's like a decision for insurance, if it's like a decision for a mortgage, it's always important that we can basically explain to people why the algorithm decided that way. So this is the first very important thing to consider. The second one that I also briefly mentioned is basically if you don't know how you can interpret your system, especially for a given input output in this case, you actually don't know how vulnerable your system is to different types of attacks. So in this case, it's called an adversarial attack. It's actually an adversarial T-shirt attack that we designed. So basically, we designed a T-shirt that you can wear, which basically just destroys the output of these algorithms. So it just makes you invisible to detection. So if you you can imagine this is actually a big problem, right? And so anyone can wear this T-shirt and, you know, can get away. So basically no pulse detection anymore. So no activity detection anymore, no face detection anymore. There's actually a glass counterpart of this. There are some papers that basically design a glass and that makes your face invisible. So without interpreting, without understanding what you're doing, such attacks are really common. This is called adversarial attacks. In this case, it's an adversarial T-shirt attack. And this is, of course, not only in vision and images, but also on natural language processing and bots and everything. So this is, I think, kind of a interesting example. So as you see here, this like interesting, let's say, account says, if you love killing animals, reply to this tweet. And then PETA says, yeah, this is a bot. Yeah, thanks for your support. Yeah, we completely support this. Right, so, I mean, these kind of cases are common because you don't know what you're doing most of the time with these systems. And it's really important to understand whether that we actually fail, the so-called fail gracefully in these cases. And yeah, this of course also extends to the first example I showed. I wanted to basically give like just show as this the last slide, just I started with faces, I want to end up with faces. So yes, I mean, face synthesis, as I said, is kind of one huge success of all these deep learning techniques, but they can also fail, right? So if you want to synthesize Simpson faces, well, they look okay-ish, but certainly that's not something an artist would do. Right, so we really need to understand what's going on to make sure that these deep systems do not go wrong, or if they go wrong, they fail gracefully. So yeah, in summary, so by the way, there's actually some artwork that an algorithm generated. So in summary, basically interpretability is really important both in academia and industry for a lot of different reasons. I just wanted to briefly talk about some of these, I just wanted to summarize a bit in this slide. Like six main points here, but of course there are more. So the first one is we want to avoid bias in the data sets as much as possible. So as I said, this really affects decisions and it makes things harder also in regression algorithms. So we want to make sure we actually don't have bias. This is like a really big thing in industry. All the data sets, you know, there's always the fear that we will actually have bias and this will destroy our algorithms, right? So interpretability is really, really important in that respect. The second one is, as I've been mentioning, understanding weaknesses of our algorithms. And if there's a weakness or if there's a way to attack the algorithm, then the algorithm should fail gracefully, right? So if we can interpret, we can say, well, this particular pixel is super important for this output, so let's make it a bit less important. Let's make actually the algorithm a bit more, for example, regularized so that we don't have this super importance for one pixel, etc. And yeah, apart from these a bit more general considerations, of course, it's really important that this discipline stays as science, not something else. So that's why we need to understand what we're doing. And this has been a big discussion. Probably you saw it in, I think, so it was in 2017, 18. There was like a panel discussion about this. So people were complaining, actually one particular professor was complaining, but actually we all, like there are so many people that share the same idea. So, you know, there has been a lot of mathematical rigor in the previous phases of, let's say, machine learning, and we start losing it a bit. So I think it's really important that we keep it, and interpretability is also important there. And finally, this is a bit different than the others, but this is really practical for people like me and my students and postdocs and researchers, etc. So to keep sanity, right? This is like a really exploding field. Computer vision, machine perception, machine learning, applications of computer graphics, visual computing, to these inverse problems, you know, all these are exploding. So I can tell you, there has been actually 1,000 papers, I think 2 years ago, at CVPR accepted. So I mean, you can multiply it with like five or six. That many papers were actually submitted, and you know, there's now this archive website, so we had to follow it regularly. You know, each month maybe 100 papers, new 100 papers I need to skim through. So basically, it's exploding. So to keep sanity, it's really important that we have some metrics. Basically, we have some way to understand what could work, what could not work, and what would fail in what cases. So yeah, hopefully we will all be keeping our sanity. This is my last word for this talk. Again, thank you very much for inviting. So I hope this was a bit informative and entertaining. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Cengiz Hocam. So this has been a more image domain interpretation of explainability. Very important, very nice. There are some questions that I would like to ask, maybe in groups or in simplicity. One is, where can I find this t-shirt that makes you invincible? But related to that, I'm sort of thinking from an earlier talk, you know, the one of the cars hitting the truck because it can't, it sees it as a sky. So, you know, you have found this t-shirt, and this deep learning models will be kept used in autonomous cars. How are we gonna, maybe we won't understand that they're, you know, how they work, but how can we, as sort of you mentioned, gracefully fail? How can we guarantee that this will never happen with a different t-shirt? Maybe I'll be invisible. If you want to say anything about that.
Yeah, this is actually a hard, I mean, it's kind of one of the, I would say, holy grails at the moment, right? I don't think this will ever be possible, just, you know, from a theoretical perspective, because you cannot have everything. So because basically you cannot have, I mean, theoretically you can, but if, like, in the next, let's say, billion years, you cannot have all cases that we will encounter on a road, for example. So I think the way to go would be really making everything as interpretable as possible. So that's what I've been working on pretty much from the visual perspective, as you mentioned. So not using generic architectures, but using components that we understand. And then inputting networks where we cannot really have any component per se. So for example, as like a concrete example, we know actually that there's a well-defined process to render an image out of a scene definition. So if you have geometries, if you have a lighting, camera, appearance, specification, etc. Then we can actually really render this scene photorealistically. So this means actually we have all the components, like the geometry, that we understand and we nicely parameterize already. So why not just use them and then define first the forward process with all these components instead of saying, well, I have a unit. Because a unit, I mean, can do something. But if you have all these understandable, interpretable components in your system, and then you say, well, in this case, maybe, yes, I have a piece of geometry, for example, a human body, but I don't know how to parameterize exactly. So then you can actually always kind of re-parameterize your parameters. And for that, you can use a small neural network, and basically that's always easier to interpret in this case. And it's kind of this combination of interpretable components and small networks here and there. I think this will be probably the way to go. And this is what I've been working on over the last, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 years. Just replacing generic architectures with much more understandable and, so basically architectures that actually, that make sense for this particular problem. Because there are certain things that we know about the problem, so we should really use them. We should use the so-called inductive biases in the frameworks.
Okay, there are many questions, so quickly. Can we apply the Shapley value concept using patches instead of single pixels? Would this help?
Of course, actually there's one way to speed this up. You can say, well, I actually divide my image into patches. For example, if you have 1,000 by 1,000 image, you can say, well, I'm just saying, okay, I have a 10 by 10 patch, and I can tile my image with these 10 by 10 patches. And then this is, of course, a much lower dimensional problem. And you can do that, of course, that will give you a little bit more like a coarse grained interpretation. But you could also imagine actually doing it at multi-scales. That's actually something we tried. And yeah, that's actually a super nice idea that we worked on a bit. And the main problem with, of course, I mean, if there is any particular pixel or like some local region, which kind of somehow really important for the network, it will be probably not there if you use 10 by 10 patches. But you can always do multi-scale. You can always do like a multi-grid almost refinement, right? So you can start like with really large patches and say, okay, in this area, it looks like something is going on, so I can refine it kind of quad tree approach, for example. Yes, this is a good idea. Exactly.
Another Volga Sezen is asked. Volga Sezen de şey diyor. Acaba şirketlerin yeterince incentive'i var mı diyor bu konularda çalışmak için.
Aslında var, çünkü şey, ilk başta bahsettiğim gibi bu kanunla da korunmaya başladı. Bu işte Right to Explanation gibi kanunlar var artık. O yüzden hani bazı şirket, bazı tabii çok kritik kararlar falan şirketlerde, bu zaten olmak zorunda. Açıkçası benim çalıştığım şirketlerde biz böyle çok aşırı kritik kararlar almıyoruz. Yani bizim çalıştığımız data, visual data, bir de tabii o autonomous driving gibi bir iş yapmıyoruz. Yani şey, benim çalıştığım organizasyonlar daha çok şey, AR mesela işleri yapıyoruz. İşte production, movie production'da uzun zaman çalıştım. İşte bu background subtraction yapıyoruz vesaire. Yani biraz daha daha az kritik işler aslında düşündüğümüz zaman bu açıdan. Ama şöyle bir sorun var. Bu şirketler çok kritik karar almasalar bile, mesela bizim bir şeyde bir sorun da bu işte background subtraction'da. Algoritmaların ne yaptığını anlamıyorsak onları geliştiremiyoruz. Yani mesela şöyle bir şey oluyor bizim günlük işimizde. İşte bu unit bize şu sonucu verdi. Bakıyor herkes ya, diyor işte bu sonuç ilginçmiş ama neden bu durumda çalışmalar dedi. İşte böyle bir sorun ortaya çıkıyor. Bu sürekli işte data'ya bak, neden çalışmadı acaba sorusunu sorunca bu sefer İşte unit'i bir şekilde anlamamız lazım. Farklı anlama şekilleri var. Yani aslında şirketler açısından bu da önemli. Bu algoritmaların performanslarını arttırmak için ya da işlemleri hızlandırmak için anlamamız lazım. Eğer anlamıyorsak bu sefer her şey, hani önce bir şuna bakalım. Unit çalışmıyorsa şurasında, işte şuradaki filtre sayısını arttıralım. Onun yerine ResNet koyalım. İşte son yeni çıkan bir network var, işte onu ekleyelim falan. Böyle sürekli işte on yap, bu çalışması, bunu yap. Bu hem çok zaman alandı işte, hem de zaten yani bizim gibi araştırmacılarında hiç sevmediğim bir şey. Çünkü biz daha çok bilimsel çalışmaya alışmış insanlarız. O yüzden şirketler arasında bu çok önemli aslında. Yani bir tek kanunla korunması değil bir şey. Bir de şey, bu performans boyutu var.
Kaynak istemiş bir başka öğrenci bu konular için.
Tabii, bilmiyorum gerçi size mi göndermem daha iyi olur ya da
şu keywordleri arayın falan diye söyleniyor veya bu paper'dan başlayın diye bazen.
Tabii şey, ya bunun hangi kısmından tabii başlamak istediğinize bağlı. Eğer genel olarak interpretable deep learning'e başlamak istiyorsanız bence direkt Google'da arayıp bu işte medium tarzı sitelerde ya da şey the gradient diye bir site var, o bayağı iyi. Onlardaki bloklara bakarsanız en iyi oradan başlamak. Yani tamamen farklı bir alana girmek istediğiniz zaman makalelerden başlamak ya da kitaplardan bile başlamak iyi bir fikir değil bence bu çağda. Genelde çok işte bu alanda çalışan insanların yazdığı bloklar var. Onlar hem genel bir giriş yapıyor hem de size insight veriyor. İşte bu problem var ve bu şu sebepten dolayı işte şu arkitektür çalışmaz gibi. Çünkü bu insanlar genelde uzun zamanda bu işlerde çalışan insanlar oluyor. O yüzden benim size verebileceğim web sitede aslında the gradient var. Bahsettiğim gibi. Belki hatta yazabilirim de istiyorsanız. Bir diğer site distill.pub diye bir site var. Distill.pub. Bu site de çok iyi. Burada da ilginç bloklar var. Buralardan başlarsanız biraz daha rahat bir başlangıç olur. Ama tabii belli bir aşamada yavaş yavaş kitaplara geçmek gerekiyor. Yani biraz daha alan anladıktan sonra. Eğer gerçekten belli bir teknik için çalışmak istiyorsanız, mesela attribution teknikleri için, o zaman tabii yavaş yavaş makalelere dönmek gerekiyor. Eğer onlardan bahsetmek isterseniz daha ayrıntılı olur.
Bertan Günyel bu arada bu linklerin bazılarını paylaşmış. Teşekkürler Bertan. Son soru, belki background subtraction ile ilgili deep learning tabanlı bir kaynak var mı demiş bir öğrenci. Onun dışında herhalde kapatabiliriz veya sizin başka bu soruya veya başka ekleyeceğiniz bir şey var mı?
Hemen cevap verin isterseniz. Background Subtraction'da şimdi makalenin sınatlarına çalışıyorum. İşte bizim birkaç sene önce bir makale var. Tabii bütün makaleleri takip edemiyorum. Dediğim gibi yüzlerce makale var. Bir de takip ettiğim çok alan var. Bunun üzerine gelmiş makaleler olacaktır. Ama zaten Google Scholar'a girerseniz onun Citation'dan da bakabilirsiniz. Sampling Based Mapping diye bir makale var bizim. CVPR'da bundan 2 sene önce yayınlandı. Oradan mesela başlayabilir size. Ama genel olarak keyword olarak chroma keying, matting diye aratırsanız zaten çıkacak makalelerin %80'i, %90'ı deep learning bazlı olacak. Yani bu bazen background subtraction diye de geçiyor. Ama daha çok endüstride kullanılan şekilde chroma keying ya da matting diye geçiyor. O şekilde aratırsanız çıkacaktır. Pardon. Son söz olarak mı şeyler söyledim ya da kapatayım mı?
Yok aslında ben bir sonraki konuşmacıyı görünce biraz şey acele ettim ama aslında aramız var. Söyleyeceğiniz bir şey varsa lütfen buyurun başka.
Çok teşekkürler tekrar davet ettiğiniz için her zaman. Yani ilk başta söylediğim gibi kusura bakmayın İngilizce, Arabik İngilizce kısım için. Yani şey bu alanlar bence çok ilginç. Bizim söylediğim gibi biraz ilk başlardaki işte bu daha saf diyeyim, bir açıdan saf machine learning. Bu işte convolutional neural networklerin böyle patlamasıyla beraber 2012 yılında image network classification başarısından sonra farklı bir alana evrildi. Benim tavsiyem bu alanlarda çalışmak istiyorsanız tabii şey önemli, hani yeni işte en son gen architecture nedir? İşte en son unit'in improvement'i nedir falan filan. Ama şey daha fundamental'lara odaklanmanızı tavsiye ediyorum. Yani çünkü çok fazla makale var, çok fazla fundamental work dedikleri şey var. Açıkçası çok fazla da işe yaramayan teknik var. Böyle bir gerçekten zoo diyorlar, bir zoo halinde şu anda alan. Çok fazla insan var, çok fazla para var. Şirketlerde bir sürü insan çalışıyor bu konularda. İşte akademiden pek çok doktor öğrencisini koparıp alıyorlar genelde. Yani şey yüksek, talep yüksek. Talep yüksek olunca böyle bir alan karıştı biraz açıkçası. Ama son zamanlarda işte bu interpretable bunun bir kısmı. Biraz daha bir yapı gelmeye başladı. Biraz daha insanlar, ha tamam biraz daha üzerinde düşünelim. Daha hani artık işte şu network'ün şurasını biraz geliştirip de %1 improvement sağlayacağımıza biraz daha fundamental'lara girelim diyen insanlar çoğaldı. Tabii biraz daha işin içinde daha matematiksel arka planları olan insanlar da geldi. O da biraz alan değiştirdi. İşte mesela ben daha çok geometrik bazı sezgileri mesela uygulamaya çalışıyorum. Machine learning'de. İşte başka biri grup teoriden bir şey uyguluyor vesaire. Biraz daha alan düzenli ya da düzenli değil mi? Değişme biraz daha hani bilimsel açıdan gelişmeye başladı diyebilirim. O yüzden benim tavsiyem bu alanda çalışmak istiyorsanız siz de daha bir fundamental'lara gidelim. Hani şey diye düşünmemiz. Yani işte ben bu mesela background subtraction'da %1 bir improvement sağlayan bir şey yapayım. CVPR'da basalım. Tabii bunu basabiliyorsunuz. Biz de onu yaptık açıkçası. Bundan birkaç sene önce bahsettiğim gibi. Bir benchmark vardı. Ama hani her zaman yapılması gereken ya da bence yapılması çok iyi olan bir şey değil. Yani bizim durumda biraz farklı. Çünkü endüstrinin istediği bir şeydi. Şirketin istediği. O yüzden yaptık. Yani benim genel olarak tavsiyem bu. Eğer herhangi bir sorunuz olursa zaten benim ismimi aradığınız zaman internetten çıkacaktır. Herhangi bir e-postama attığınız zaman en kısa zamanda cevap vermeye çalışacağım. Onun haricinde işte bu alanlar şey, endüstri ile akademinin çok bir araya geldiği alanlar. O açıdan da çok ilginç aslında. Tabii bazı araştırmacılar için, ya ben de ilk başta öyle düşünüyorum, daha akademik işte bu blue sky tabir ettikleri araştırma daha ilginç. Ama aslına baktığınız zaman endüstriden çok ilginç problemler geliyor. Çok ilginç çözümler de geliyor. Daha pratik çözümler de geliyor. O yüzden ben şu ana kadar şeyden çok memnunum. Bu işte endüstri, akademi, işte hem oradan hem buradan farklı şekillerin alınması, problemlerin işte birleştirilmesi vesaire. O şekilde de çalışmak istiyorsanız onun hakkında tabii daha uzun konuşabiliriz. Genel olarak söyleyeceklerim bunlar. Tekrar çok teşekkür ederim. Umarım biraz faydası olmuştur.
Kesinlikle. Çok çok teşekkür ediyorum. Sağ olun katıldığınız için. Şimdi yarım saat bir aramız var. Sonra ana konuşmayla devam edeceğiz saat 5'te. Sağ olun Cengiz Hocam.
Size teşekkür ederim. İnşallah stop sharing'ı. Tamam.